Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship today. If you did not pick up a bulletin when you came into worship, please just raise your hand and one of the ushers will bring one to you if you need one. The service is printing the bulletin, so if you don't have one, you might find yourself wondering what's going on. In our service today, we're going to introduce you to a new hymn from the worship supplement, We Walk by Faith and Not by Sight. We'll join to sing that at the after the invocation. As we worship our Lord this morning, we ask that God would be with us and bless us. Sometimes we ask the question in life, what's in it for me, even when it comes to church work? And God answers that question for us today by His grace and by His favor. We're reminded always that we are children of God for Jesus' sake. May God bless our worship this morning. We begin our worship in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. We join to sing hymn number 756 in your worship folder. Come into the presence of God who created us to love and serve Him as His dear children. But we have disobeyed Him and deserve only His wrath and punishment. Therefore, let us confess our sins to Him and plead for His mercy. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against You and do not deserve to be called Your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to Your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, He has removed your guilt forever. You are His own dear child. May God give you strength to live according to His will.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Please open up your hymnals to page 39. We'll sing, O Taste and See That the Lord is Good. Oh, Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, you call us to work in your kingdom and leave no one standing idle. Help us to order our lives by your wisdom and to serve you in willing obedience through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. All of our reading this morning remind us of the amazing grace of God. In spite of us often, God showers his grace and mercy upon us all. We hear these words from Jonah chapter 5, Jonah chapter 4, verses 5 to 11. Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city. He made a shelter for himself there and sat in the shade under it, waiting to see what would happen in the city. Then the Lord God provided a plant and made it grow up over Jonah to provide shade over his head to relieve him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm, and it attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind. The sun beat down on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die, so he said, "It's better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" Jonah said, "I do have a right to be angry, angry enough to die." So the Lord said, "You have become concerned about this plant. You did not work for it or make it grow. It grew up in one night and perished after one night. So should I not be concerned for Nineveh, the great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know the difference between their right hand and their left, and also many animals?" This is the word of the Lord. The psalm this morning is Psalm 27. You'll find that on page 75 in the front of your hymnal. We'll sing the refrain and the glory be to the Father together. I'll sing the first line of each psalm verse. I invite you to join to sing the second line of each psalm verse.
Lord.
Our second lesson is the epistle lesson for the day from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 9, the last half of verse 6 through verse 16. This does not mean that God's word has failed, because not all who are descended from Israel are really Israel, and not all who are descended from Abraham are really his children. On the contrary, your line of descent will be traced through Isaac. This means that it is not the children of the flesh who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are counted as his descendants. But this is what the promise said: I will arrive at this set time and Sarah will have a son. Not only that, but Rebekah also had children by one man, our forefather Isaac. Even before the twins were born or did anything good or bad, in order that God's purpose and election might continue, not by works, but because of him who calls us, it was said to her, the older will serve the younger. Just as it is written, Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated. What will we say then? Does this mean that God is unjust? Absolutely not. For God says to Moses, I will show mercy to whom I show mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. So then, it does not depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. This is the word of the Lord. Alleluia, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Alleluia. Alleluia. The gospel lesson. The Holy Gospel is according to the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 20. We hear the first 16 verses. Indeed, the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. After agreeing to pay the workers a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. He also went out about the third hour and saw others standing unemployed in the marketplace. To these he said, you also go into the vineyard, and I will give you whatever is right. So they went. Again he went out about the sixth and the ninth hour and did the same thing. When he went out about the 11th hour, he found others standing unemployed. He said to them, why have you stood here all day unemployed? They said to him, because no one hired us. He told them, you also go into the vineyard. When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the workers and pay them their wages, starting with the last group and ending with the first. When those who were hired around the 11th hour came, they each received a denarius. When those who were hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but they each received a denarius too. After they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. Those who were last worked 1 hour, and you made them equal to us who have endured the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he answered one of them, friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not make an agreement with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go. I want to give to the last one hired the same as I also gave to you. Can't I do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? In the same way, the last will be first and the first last. This is the gospel of our Lord. Continue with the hymn of the day, hymn 390. You may be seated. Thank you. grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God for our attention this morning are the words we heard from the gospel a few moments ago from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. Let me share with you the last verse. In the same way, the last will be first, and the first last. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus had just finished explaining to a rich young man how dangerous wealth can be. He taught the man that a love for money can stand in the way of a person's love for God. Peter, again, as we heard last week, was paying attention. And as he learned from that lesson, as that man went away sorrowful because he had much wealth, he had a question for Jesus. And the question before our text in chapter 19 went like this. Look, we have left everything and followed you. What then will we have? You get the question, don't you? Peter's wondering, what's in it for me? He's been a devoted follower of Jesus, a faithful servant of the Lord, and he wants to know, what's in it for me? I've left everything, given up house and home, wealth, and a good vocation on the lake. Now what? You know how it goes that it happens all the time, you know. There's some times when we don't feel very much appreciated. We seem to be taken advantage of by family. We seem to be taken advantage of at the workplace. Oftentimes, we don't even receive so much as a thank you for all the effort we put into the things we do. And sometimes we wonder, you know, what's the point? And the next time somebody asks you to do something, wouldn't you just like, instead of saying, sure, how can I help you? Wouldn't you like to just say, what's in it for me? Come on. We'd all like to know that once in a while, wouldn't we? As you and I listen to this portion of God's word, the Lord is going to prick our conscience and reveal our sin and our selfishness. But when we consider that question, what's in it for me? Realize that there needs to be an attitude adjustment inside of all of us. And at the same time, if we understand that question properly, we can see in that question a gracious gift from God. Well, you know the story perhaps quite well. There were day laborers waiting to be hired. And a man who owned a vineyard went out to hire people in his vineyard. He cut a deal at the beginning of the day with those who were hired first. This is the deal. The kingdom of heaven, like a landowner, went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. After agreeing to pay the workers a denarius for the day, he sent them into his vineyard. So, here's the deal. You work all day and I'll give you an honest day wage, which was a denarius. Well, as the day went on, the owner of the vineyard decides he's going to hire more workers. So he goes out again and again to hire workers, but this time he doesn't make the deal with them. He simply sells to those who were hired a little later, you also go into the vineyard and I will give you whatever is right. Not knowing what right would be, these men also agreed to go and work. They were happy for the work. But an hour before quitting time, the owner of the vineyard goes out and he found others standing unemployed. He said to them, why have you stood here all day unemployed? Well, they said to him, because no one hired us. He told them, you also go into the vineyard. Now, the ones who were hired at the 11th hour weren't promised any pay whatsoever. They were just happy for the work. They were overjoyed to have work for the day. Where I come from, there were day laborer offices where people could go and stand in line and hope that somebody needed some help that day. Maybe one of the landscaping crews, maybe some roofers, maybe some sheetrockers needed some extra help. They were overloaded and they needed some day laborers. And so they would go there and hope that someone would hire them, and they were willing to do anything. It didn't matter. They just needed work. So this is the picture you have. Some worked all day, some didn't work so long. But you know the rest of the story, don't you? At the end of the day, the people who were hired last and worked only an hour, they were paid first. They received a denarius, a full day's wage. Well, the people who had been there all day long, they watch all this and they think to themselves, wow, if those guys got a full day's wage, I mean, we ought to get like 10 times that amount. They're pretty excited when it's pay time for them. They get to the line and they receive their pay, and they also receive a denarius. And they're screaming, this isn't fair. Told her in text. After they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. Those who were last worked 1 hour, and you had made them equal to us who have endured the burden of the day and the scorching heat. You know, you and I live in a world where we believe that it ought to be equal pay for equal work, right? That's the way it's supposed to be. And there's nothing about this story that sounds fair to us. But remember, this is a story to teach a spiritual truth. Martin Luther had this to say about the story. He said this about this parable. He said, Christ simply desires to show in this parable that God judges and operates in a strange manner. He makes the first the last, and the last the first. He humbles those who are something so that they learn to rely on nothing but the bare mercy and compassion of God. And conversely, he will not have those who are nothing to despair, but have them also rely on God's goodness just as well as the first. When you and I consider the thought, what's in it for me, that's usually an indication that we need an attitude adjustment. We like to think that we ought to receive something for all of our work. We can have that attitude also when we join a church family. In our back of our minds, we can ask ourselves, what's in it for me? If I join this church, I have a place to get married, a place to get buried. I have a place to give myself, my children, a wonderful Christian education. It doesn't cost me much of anything. It's a place where I can connect with other people, get to know people in the congregation. Maybe I can get something from them. Maybe they're experts in electrical work or plumbing or automotive work, and maybe they can cut me a deal from time to time. If I join that congregation, get acquainted with everybody, maybe there's something that I can get out of it. And you know, at the end of the day, it's true. You do get something out of all of this. You get your denarius. And if that's all you want out of church, that's all you're going to get. You can take your denarius and you can go to hell. We need an attitude adjustment, you see. We don't go to church to see what we can get out of it. We come to church to realize the gracious gift that God has given to me. What's in it for you? Why are you here? It doesn't matter whether you've been a Christian for 10 minutes or 100 years. What's in it for us is the gracious gift that God has to offer us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Should we be stingy with that grace? Should we resent those who haven't had it as long as we have, who haven't known what Christ has done for us? The person who on his deathbed confesses faith in Jesus Christ and receives a Christian funeral, who hasn't sweated at all to keep this building afloat, who hasn't done anything for the work of the church, and He's treated as our equal. Should we resent that somehow? Should we think that somehow or other, because we've slaved and worked for this church all the days of our life, that somehow or other God owes us a favor? Oh, my friend, if that's the case, we need an attitude adjustment, don't we? What's in it for us? It's this gracious gift from God. The gracious gift that God wants us to serve in his kingdom. And if you've been privileged to serve him since you were a tiny infant at that baptismal font, or whether you've only been able to serve him for a few months or a few years or even for a few hours, it is still by grace that we're saved, isn't it? And what a privilege it is every time we wake up and the green side's still up, that we have an opportunity that day to live to the praise and glory of God. My friends, that's the message Jesus would teach us today. And you and I are like that pauper at the end of the line. God in his grace still comes searching for us. And he allows us to work in his kingdom. And it's not about the things we get to do. Oh, those are done as an expression of gratitude to God for us. It's about what God has done for us. He has favored us, chosen us, showered us with his grace and goodness. The blood that Jesus shed on the cross, he reminds us that that blood was shed for us. He comes to us in water, bread, and wine, means of grace, and body and blood of our Lord under those elements, the blessings of salvation under the water, and he reassures us and reminds us that all the blessings of salvation are yours, free of charge. You and I are like Paul, the least of all God's people. And yet this favor is showing us, this grace, that we have the privilege to serve the Lord in his kingdom. Never take that for granted. If you've been a Christian for as long as you can remember, thank God for that grace and mercy that God has shown to you. If you've been a Christian just for a short time, thank God for the grace and mercy God has shown you. No matter how long or we have been a child of God, we ought always to marvel at this gracious gift that's been shown to us. What's in it for us? Everlasting life, isn't it? And it's not because we get to serve the Lord that we have everlasting life. It's because of what God has done for us in Jesus Christ that we have everlasting life. And so we serve the Lord as an expression of gratitude to God. To the praise and glory of God, we live our lives each day, don't we? And every day when we get out of bed, here's another day, another opportunity to let the light of salvation shine forth in our lives to the people we rub elbows with. That's what's in it for us. What's in it for us is an opportunity for us to tell our friends and our neighbors that we have a God who is greater than the heavens. Who can fathom the height and depth, the marvels of God's grace that overflow on sinners like us? And yet God has showered us with this wonderful gift of salvation. I always remember what's in it for you. As a member of St. Paul's, as a child of God by his grace, what's in it for you is a gracious gift of everlasting life that God has won for you in Jesus our Lord. You and I don't work for pay. We do our work as an offering of thanksgiving to God for what he has given to us at such great cost. The forgiveness of sins by his own grace and mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please rise. And the peace of God who surpasses all understanding will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We respond to the word of God by joining to confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, printed in your worship folder. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Please rise for prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we humbly come before you with repentant hearts. Our lives seem to be an unending succession of sinful thoughts, words, and actions. Lustful thoughts have flooded our sinful hearts. Our impatience has turned to anger, and our anger has at times given way to desires for revenge. The sweet words of love and forgiveness that we should have spoken have sometimes been replaced with sharp and hurtful words. So often we have opted for empty earthly pleasures instead of the heavenly treasures that you give to us through your word and sacraments. We have not loved our neighbors as we have loved ourselves. Greed, envy, and covetousness have displaced contentment and satisfaction too often in our hearts. We have even kept for ourselves the goods we should have shared with you and those in need. Our faith is too weak. We complain. We forget to pray. We doubt. Father, you know us and our sins even better than we do. You know the sins that remain hidden from our knowledge. Cleanse us from these sins, too. We know that your plans are higher than our plans. Give us contentment in life, knowing that your grace has saved us all. Heaven awaits us only because of the love and compassion you have showered on us through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Fill our lives with peace and joy as we serve you each day of our lives. Comfort those who are sick. Strengthen those who are weak. Rekindle faith in all our hearts. Fill us with thankfulness for the blessings you pour over us each day. Restore to us the joy of your salvation so freely provided for us all through the blood that Jesus shed for us on the cross. Make us realize that our bodies are the temples and dwelling places of the Holy Spirit, so that with untiring zeal we present ourselves to you for Christian service, ready to do every good work. All this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, who rose from the dead on Easter morning to announce to the world that he has conquered sin, death, and the power of the devil to redeem us to you for time and for eternity. Amen. We join in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll continue with the singing of the next hymn, hymn 401. Let us pray. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation. And bestow on us your saving peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive with believing hearts the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Seated for the closing and fill our hearts with humble joy that we get each day to live our lives to God's glory and praise and touch the lives of others with God's great message of salvation. A couple of announcements. After the service today, there's going to be two young men from Luther High in the basement, one offering you fruit and one offering you beef. So go downstairs and purchase some of these wonderful things. There's one, Joshua Stratman is selling fruit. And Mike, help me with his last name. There you go. He'll be downstairs selling beef. So come down and purchase those. Those things are the beef is for the trap club at Luther High, and the fruit is for the band at Luther High. So, all right? The things that are going on this week, I guess, are in the bulletin. I was going to announce that Mark Larson has been teaching a Bible history class for public school 5th and 6th graders, but we have all the 5th and 6th graders in our day school, I guess, so we don't have any, so that that class is not meeting now, so that's a good news, bad news kind of thing. So after the class, we're having our Bible study for about half an hour downstairs. We're slowly but surely working our way through St. Paul's letter to Ephesians. Join us if you would like. We're doing a Tuesday night, Wednesday morning Bible class on the minor prophets, and we're trying to practice the social distancing, just to follow the guidelines that the governor of the state of Wisconsin has given. So we try to keep everybody safe, but if you'd like to join us, join us. If you can't, we understand that too. You guys have a wonderful day, all right?